Thank you, everybody, for joining us today for this book launch. A book looking at President Obama's early formative years in Hawaii and Indonesia, the part of his life that's kind of least known about, at least thus far, given the biographies that have come out, that are adding up in numbers. I think hundreds of biographies have already come out in the 3 years that he's been president. But the years that he spent in Hawaii and Indonesia, the first 18 years of his life, have not been that well researched or written about or talked about. So that's the theme of my book. So I welcome you all for joining us here today. So the title of our the discussion today is really the making of Barack Obama, right? The early formative years, which is also the main theme of the book. It's a psychological as well as a cultural issue that we look at throughout the book. I want to thank Professor Gielen for hosting this event and for sponsoring the book at the Institute for International and Cross-Cultural Research. I also want to thank Professor Maloney, Ian Maloney, in the Honors Program for hosting this event, and the Psychology Department at St. Francis, where I've been associated with for many years as a consultant, and then throughout, for the last 10 years or so, where I've been writing various books on culture and emotion in India, and now this cultural biography on the president. For a special gathering of this kind, I think it's appropriate to kind of evoke the tribal elders, if you will, the memory of a few of the professors who've taught us over the years and have shaped our thinking. And foremost, Lawrence Kohlberg, the great theorist of moral development at Harvard, who taught Professor Gielen and myself a number of years ago, comes to mind. And then Professor David McClellan, the great personality theorist, again, at social relations at Harvard, who taught Professor Gielen and myself. And their influence is, running throughout this book as well. Now, there are many lessons, of course, I've learned in writing this book. One thing's for sure, that when you write a book about a sitting president, there's no shortage of research material, because the situation is always fluid and always changing, right? So, for instance, in our house, it's like wall-to-wall coverage, with 24/7 cable news and web blogs and all the information that pours in these days. We're kind of flooded with information about Obama, kind of wall-to-wall coverage. And it's one of the best things actually I've done in many years, being a social scientist, because I still get to theorize and pontificate about the world and shock people with my zany ideas about what I think is going on. And then I read the blogs and I listen to cable news and conservative radio talk show hosts, and I realize my theories are not that off base. They're actually pretty grounded and sane. So the political circus that I was referring to a minute ago, so if you look at on the top left corner, you see President Obama at the cover of Economist in June. He's looking at the teeming Republican primary race, which is about to begin, and he's asking himself that he could still lose this election, possibly, given the diversity of candidates that are out there on the Republican side. And then in the middle, top middle, is Donald Trump, demanding that President Obama produce the long-form death certificate of Osama bin Laden, who's just been killed. And then to the top right, you have Herman Cain, the new entrant, who's at the top of the poll in the Republican primaries now, based on the recent polls, who's claiming that he doesn't want just one slice, he wants the whole damn pizza, which is the GOP party. And then in the middle, in the bottom middle, there's a couple that's saying the Tea Party is racist. And out comes Herman Cain with a pizza. He's serving them pizza, further shocking them. and then here, President Obama trying to figure out, he's sort of caged and hanging upside down, trying to figure out what happened to his poll numbers, because they've plummeted, by 20 points or something. And then he's asking himself, is it that my assistant, who had a trunk and tusks, had something to do with it, namely the Republican Party? And then over there in the corner, President Obama having a golf outing with Speaker Boehner, and he's saying to himself, this course is, impossible. So this is the kind of environment we're in right now. So what I have to say is actually pretty down to earth and grounded, right? So the main claim of the book, and before we go to Maya, who's going to come in at the opening, and then I'll follow through, I'll follow up on her comments. The main theme really of the book is, and based on the research, right? So is that President Obama is really a sign of the changing times, right? This may seem counterintuitive, but it's true, it's factually true that he is the product of globalization, American capitalism, and a unique form of multiculturalism that America has fostered around the world, all right? That's really the main claim of the book, based on the ground research in Hawaii and in Indonesia, and in the mainland, in New York, Chicago, the places where he's lived. This, as Maya just talked about in detail, is the kind of the global competence that President Obama acquired in Hawaii and Indonesia. And I look at it more systematically. She just gave us, you know, a great kind of narrative, a personal narrative about what it was like for her to grow up with a mother who was an anthropologist and a world traveler. And we've not had this historically. We've not had a mother of a president, as I talk about in the book in detail, who was an anthropologist. I think somebody can correct me if they know presidential history or about history of parents or raising a president. I know there are biographies and books out there that talk about parents of presidents and their lives and characteristics, but I don't. I'm pretty sure that we've not had a mother who was an anthropologist who lived overseas in Indonesia, Southeast Asia in particular, and then raised a son to become the first black president of the United States in the 232 years of its history. So really, that's really kind of what informs my main thesis in the book, which is that Barack Obama is a sign of the changing times, a product of globalization, spurred by American power, free market capitalism, and a unique form of multiculturalism, which is what I was saying earlier. So now, I didn't really realize how true or valid this statement was till I actually started to research the childhood and adolescence of Barack Obama, the 44th president of the United States. As the historian Douglas Brinkley has said, who's, you know, who's a well-known commentator on many channels, he said in a recent interview that Obama really came of age really after the Cold War, with the internet being the transformative engine of society, and now he takes his multicultural heritage and the geographical diversity of his upbringing to the world. So as Maya's, you know, narrative just painted the picture, you know, with a lot of color and detail, that this is a unique heritage that that our president, you know, acquired in those early years. And this is really kind of what I came to terms with when I researched his early years in Hawaii and Indonesia. And writing this book, in a way, gave me an opportunity to actually understand better the changing nature of American society and politics and culture, and why we may have elected, as I argue in the book, our first global president. Again, borrowing a phrase from Douglas Brinkley, who's made this claim that Obama is really our first global president. Now, despite the risks and trepidation involved in writing a book about a current president, I feel a sense of cautious optimism about the American experiment, or what Ronald Reagan called a rendezvous with destiny, begun in the first half of the 20th century, which now is a global phenomenon and touches every citizen literally on the planet. Right? Everybody's affected by, in some ways, American capitalism, American power in terms of military power, as well as its multicultural and global brands around the world, you know, that circulate through consumer culture or through internet and so on and so forth. And as we look over the horizon, Barack Obama's globe-trotting and diverse formative years in Hawaii and Indonesia, the central focus of the book, really signal the beginning of an interconnected world and a global age, where America's role, emerging role in the 21st century, is still evolving. Right, there's already a good biography out on President Obama called The Bridge by the New Yorker, David Remnick, senior editor for New Yorker, called The Bridge. And it's really talking about race and African-American history and the bridge that John Lewis commented that he crossed with Martin Luther King in Selma, Alabama. And that's, you know, that's sort of the authoritative biography. And then I kind of try to expand on that book by saying that Obama, in some ways, as our first global president, is really the bridge to the 21st century, if you will, to borrow a phrase from Bill Clinton, who used that a number of years ago, kind of trying to finish the project begun by the earlier Democratic administration, the bridge to the 21st century. So, you know, at least for now, it appears that when we look at Obama's biography, that it has become intertwined with this nation's destiny, at least for the near future, right? And as Shakespeare said, what is past is prologue, a quotation also engraved at the National Archives building in Washington, D.C., we might be able to glean some interesting insights about our collective future by peering into Obama's early years. So, you know, and in the book, I try to do a kind of a back to the future kind of a frame where I go back to look at the life of this president and then and see how we elected him and what that says about our global future. Now, I came to know Barack Obama in 2007, well before the primaries, and at the time, at a dinner party, I just, you know, I talk about this in the book, but I'll relay you the story informally. I met a then campaign worker. We didn't know that she was a campaign worker at the time. She was a former classmate of President Obama from the Harvard Law School, and she predicted that, if he wins Iowa in the primaries, that the rest of the strategy will fall into place. So we were, at the time, we were kind of dumbfounded. We didn't know what was going on. And because Hillary Clinton was at the top of the Democratic heap of candidates at the time in 2007, and so, you know, women were utterly shocked. How could this be? How could Hillary Clinton not be the nominee for the Democratic ticket in 2008? And they demanded to know what was going on. And she said, well, Obama's a one in a million candidate, and that if he wins the Iowa primaries, then the rest of the strategy will fall into place, and that Hillary Clinton's negatives were very high. So she was not the ideal candidate at the time. This was in Midtown, Manhattan, at a Mexican restaurant. I simply was like, you know, eating guacamole and drinking iced tea, trying to think to myself, this woman is really drinking the Kool-Aid, right? Because nobody at the time thought, even in the African American community, that President Obama, would win the race. This is 2 years, of course, before the election ended. But having spent many years in the Midwest and then on the East Coast, I was willing, obviously, to entertain the idea that the country was ready to elect a president like Barack Hussein Obama. But obviously, we all were looking for kind of the quantitative hard evidence. People like us who do research wanted to know, what are the actual numbers, and we were all wondering at the time about the Bradley effect, and that people would say something and do something else in the polling booth and so on and so forth, and all kinds of, voting electoral effects that come into play when people actually go to the voting booth and pull the lever and they change their mind at the last minute. So we were all speculating, the results will really come out on November 4th, 2008, and that's when we'll really know what people are thinking and feeling and going through. And so, a paradigmatic moment did take place, or a change did take place in the country. And that's what's shown here. So in today's political climate, Obama's victory speech in Grand Park, Chicago may seem like a long time ago. However, at the beginning of 2009, the two events that kind of stood out in my mind was clearly the Obama inaugural and the Hollywood-Bollywood crossover film Slumdog Millionaire, which won the Best Picture that year, which was also, certainly people in the Asian community thought it was quite a fluke how an Asian picture, because many pictures had tried before, and how Slumdog managed to win that year was a surprise to a lot of us. Both events were also meaningfully connected in the popular culture, as many editorial writers noted the synergy between the improbable Obama win and this rags to riches story that went on to win the best picture that year. Because both stories were really about outsiders who come from margins of society, fringes of society, and then go on to win the big prize. Okay. Frank Ridge, for instance, in the New York Times at the time reported, observing the populist elation at the Obama victory, he wrote, "We'll soon remember that the country is in a deep ditch, and that we turned to the black guy not only because we hoped he would lift us up, but because he looked like the strongest leader to dig us out at the time." Okay? In an article written shortly after the election, Pico Iyer, a travel writer who writes for Times and Newsweek, observed, and Pico Iyer had already met Obama, I think, on a beach in Waikiki well before the primaries, and had chatted with him when Obama was a senator, and really was impressed by him. And he's written about this and blogged about this, so you can actually find it if you're interested. Google it. And he said in this piece right after the election, a new president smiles less than did his predecessor, and many of us feel better for it. On a recent episode of the Japanese version of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, one question noted that the ringing word Barack Obama kept out of his inauguration address was not freedom or peace, but dream, observed Iyer. Iyer noted further that Obama spoke of hope and opportunity and the youthfulness of America, something that the planet craves, but those who have read Obama's autobiography know that he comes from an older and more qualified place. His memoir is about the shock of discovering who his father really was, and his hybrid racial identity. Throughout the book, Obama describes how he was unsettled and haunted by his father's real image and by the oppression he had witnessed, and the poverty he had seen in Jakarta, or in the streets of Jakarta. His tone in recent months has been prudently sober, refusing to talk too easily of happy endings or quick victories, said Iyer. This may be the best development of the new century, an American president who's willing to wake America up from his dream. What's being outsourced now are American dreams and Hollywood endings, suggested Iyer, this travel writer. After all, in the Oscar race, Slumdog Millionaire eclipsed homegrown movies about a murdered San Francisco revolutionary, a dark night, and a prematurely old little boy. Right? So now, shifting gears a little, fast-forwarding to the current situation, we know that Americans as a people prefer openness and transparency and change, and that's one of the reasons why they elected President Obama. But they obviously want the change instantly or immediately. And while a segment of the American population who voted for Obama may have understood that they must adapt to the rapidly changing world around them, their systems of governance, economy, and infrastructure have not fully caught up with the major sort of systemic changes that are taking place around us, or globally. And major segments of the American population are still wrestling with the idea of the change that is taking place that President Obama promised, right? And some of them certainly believe that change is neither necessary nor welcome, and they want their country back, right? To quote a well-known phrase heard at Tea Party rallies. The economists have noted that America thrives on the principle of creative destruction. You know, all we have to do is look at Wall Street in terms of what's going on. And technology diffusion is in some ways the best metaphor for understanding creative destruction and how wealth is created, how new technologies are created, and how wealth is destroyed, and how technology is upgraded and changing, ever-changing in our culture today. And thus, many of the forces of change that we're grappling with now are really driven in some ways by technological globalization, in many cases invented by American companies and startups and venture firms, right, who are now global. Indeed, many it could be argued that many of Barack Obama's changes or proposals for changes are asking us to adopt new technologies in our lives, whether it's in terms of healthcare or energy or education. And the enduring lesson here might be that change is hard. It's not quick. It doesn't happen overnight or rapidly or in 3 years. Especially, turn of the century type of change. As we enter a new century, our old models for understanding and scoping the world now are limited. Right, so in this book, I look at President Obama's political rise as the first African-American president, and I find that there are other sort of major trends that underlie his rise, and they're also present in his biography, in his cultural biography, as his sister just pointed out in some detail. So the cultural context where he grew up is important, namely Hawaii and Indonesia, and I talk about that in the book in detail. The psychological factors or the developmental factors, growing up with a single mom because his father left the family when President Obama was just 2 years old. Growing up with a single mom who was doing anthropology and international development in Southeast Asia is also significant because it informs his kind of view of the world. A global view of the world. and it explains his underlying motivations in some ways. So now, primarily because of these reasons, I was compelled to do a cultural biography. You know, looking at his life, not just through the prism of race and politics, but through the prism of culture and globalization. Okay. Now, a number of books have already come out on President Obama, as I said earlier. You know, when he was running, there were biographies coming out on his life. And then The Bridge, which is another authoritative biography. And then there have been books that have come out about his first year in the White House, second year in the White House. And then there are a whole track of books from the right, from the conservative right-wing perspective that try to do a slash and burn kind of a job on the president to try to show how he's a Manchurian candidate, or how he's a socialist, how he's a closet Muslim, how he's a radical from the, you know, from Saul Alinsky kind of school of thought, and how he's an anti-colonial administrator, which is a new one, new label that's been added to his list of biographies. So last time when I presented this, somebody said your namesake, you know, Dinesh D'Souza says, a conservative writer, that he's an anti-colonial administrator. And I was kind of fumbling to, you know, gather my notes on this to figure out how to answer that question. I certainly don't believe that. And Dinesh D'Souza says this based on a paper that President Obama's father wrote in 1967, I think, or 64, where there's a line in that paper which says that, because he was talking about Kenyan economy and how Africa needs to develop after independence, and that the government could tax the Kenyan people almost 100% to foster economic development. And he takes this line of reasoning to say, well, this is what President Obama's trying to do. He's just trying to tax us into oblivion. Anyway, so he's anti-colonial. Anyway, if you guys have questions about that, I'm really not the best person to answer those types of questions. But anyway, so a number of books have already come out from various perspectives. And my book is different in the sense that I'm doing a cultural biography, and I'm looking at his life empathically, as a psychologist or as an anthropologist would do, trying to understand his life in the various contexts in which he was rooted as a young man, and as an adolescent, and as a college student in New York, and then in Chicago, in LA and then New York, and then as a community organizer in Chicago. Okay. And Professor Gielen can fill you in on this in terms of the debate that's been raging for the last 30 years within psychology itself about the importance of context and why context matters, right? So my book is kind of a testament to why context matters in a way, in the sense that context shapes your behavior, your ideas, your psyche, your way of looking at things and so on. So there's a lot of evidence on this already, and I draw upon a lot of this evidence to make the case that you know, Obama's way of looking at the world was shaped by having grown up in the Pacific, in Hawaii, and having lived in Indonesia. Right? And this book moves chronologically and thematically from Obama's birth in Hawaii. I know there are disputes about this still. Just a couple days ago, somebody was saying, Mr. Trump was saying that the birth certificate is not real, it's forged, or it's fake. Anyway, we're not going to visit that issue today. Certainly can't solve that issue. But I do discuss this whole issue within the context of, you know, how we understand the birth of the first African-American president who was born in Hawaii, which was the last state to join the Union in 1959. So it was this far-off place, a collection of islands that was made part of the United States in 59 after World War II. Hawaii had wanted to be part of the United States for many years, almost a century, but America had kept pushing Hawaiians back from not incorporating them as part of the United States. Then, World War II happens, and Hawaiians fight in the war for their country, and then Hawaii, and some of them go on to become senators, and then Hawaii is gradually incorporated as the 50th state to join the Union. Does anyone guess what the 49th state was before Hawaii? Alaska, right, there you go. So that explains the Sarah Palin phenomenon. We won't talk about that as well here, but anyway, so it is kind of interesting that we have, you know, two political actors in our global kind of age today, who are from some of the far kind of outlying states, the last states to kind of join the American the Union, the United States of America, as we call them. So I think context is important, right? So, and there's a lot of evidence. You could argue in President Obama's speeches as well, and his wife, Michelle Obama, has said on many occasions that if you really want to understand Barack, you have to understand Hawaii, right? Because as his sister just pointed out, Hawaii, because it has a unique mix of ethnicities and cultures, has a unique history as an island state. It has a different kind of a work ethic and a different political structure. There are no particular ethnic groups that have a hold on the power. It's one-third Asian, one-third Caucasian, one-third Native. And certainly when President Obama was growing up in Hawaii in the 70s, that was the case. And that has clearly impacted his temperament in some ways, one could argue. And that's one of the points that I make in the book, that Hawaii in some ways reflects not only the past, but also the future of where the United States is heading demographically. So just systematically moving along quickly, the moment of transformation, the Obama election was transformational. That's kind of where I begin. That's the first chapter. And I use the language in the opening chapter almost very much like what President Obama used while he was running for office. He was talking about large-scale transformational change, that he was a transformative president, that we were going to change the world. And while, clearly some of that was rhetorical, but it was very effective, and everybody was very excited about it. So it really had an impact on the population. And not only as a messaging tool, but also as describing, I think to some extent, the real change that is taking place in the United States, right? And this is reflected in to some extent in his biography. Right? So he's clearly the first African American president, but also the first multicultural head of any Western democracy. So Canada and Australia have had multiculturalism as a policy, but they've not elected a multicultural head of state. America has. Born and raised in Hawaii, schooled in Jakarta, African father who went back to Africa, which has never happened before, and an American mother who was an anthropologist. Okay, again, this is also a historical first. And a first president who's, half white, half Caucasian, half black, if you look at his genealogy or genealogically. And I presented this presentation in Chicago. And one of my former professors was there from who's now head of psychology at Northwestern, and he kind of described his reaction at the election when he was talking to his mom right before the election, who lives in Indiana, obviously a Caucasian mom in her 70s probably, most likely. And she was describing to this former professor of mine how she's going to vote for Barack Obama. And Professor McAdams was surprised. He said to his mom, said, "Mom, but he's black." And his mom said, "Yes, Danny, but he's half white." And and Professor McAdams was like totally like elated. It was like victory. Finally, we've gotten through. So that's kind of what the moment was in 2008, right? That his racial identity really gravitated a lot of people to vote for him, from all sort of sides of the political spectrum. All right. And then moving right along, context and complexities, we've been talking about this sort of round and round a little bit, and of course Maya's talk earlier also talked about this. So here are the pictures. That's Maya, actually, at the age of, I think, 1 year old, or less than that, in Indonesia. She's sitting in her mom's lap, and that's her father, and that's Barry. He was known as Barry Soetor-Ng in those days. And the picture is taken in late 1970, early 1971, in Jakarta. And then there's a picture of President Obama being scaffolded by his mom, Ann Dunham. And then a portrait of his father, Obama Sr. So if pictures, tell 1,000 stories, these pictures certainly tell a lot of interesting stories. So as a result of his mother's second marriage to an Indonesian man, when Obama was 6 years old, he moved to Jakarta, commencing his home-to-school developmental transition, as developmental psychologists like to call it. And this is significant because the early developmental transition kind of shapes your way of looking at the world. And in President Obama's case, he was making this transition really in Indonesia, because he was living in Indonesia and started to go to school, elementary school, first, second, third, fourth grade, in schools in Jakarta, and that really colored his way of looking at the world for a multitude of reasons. Namely, because Indonesia is the largest Islamic democracy in the world, a lot of his friends were and neighbors were Islamic, as well as Christian, Buddhist, Hindus, and other, you know, various other religions. And he also witnessed kind of deep poverty on the streets of Jakarta, because Indonesia was a developing country at the time. He hadn't seen anything like that in Hawaii, right? And this was also a source of, you know, interesting kind of observation, as well as lessons for him about, as he talks about it, in terms of how fate in some ways can determine your life if you're born an Indonesian child versus a white child versus a black child. Also in Indonesia, because his parents were working for American companies, his stepfather was working for American oil companies, he had a direct kind of insight into the influence of American business, which was making inroads into Indonesia at the time. And his mother was teaching English to the business Indonesian businessmen who were trying to do business with American oil companies and other types of business companies, right? That also gave him an insight into how American values, both soft power through business as well as hard power through military exercises and training, was making inroads into Indonesia. Interestingly, Obama's time in Indonesia was the only stretch of time during his childhood when he actually lived within a traditional family, because his father had left the family at the age of two. And at this age, when a child's mind is highly imaginative, and according to Piaget's cognitive phase of concrete operational thinking is tinged with a kind of moral intuition and magical thinking, President Obama wrote an essay in third grade expressing his dream, as it was called then. The essay was to write a dream, what is your dream? And he wrote that it was his wish to be president one day at the age of nine in third grade, because he wanted everybody to be happy. Okay. And I talk about this narrative in the book in detail, because I interviewed several of his teachers. I'm going to fast forward and then come back. This is his Indonesian school, and these are the three teachers that I interviewed in my research: Mrs. Sinaga, Mrs. Dharmawan, and Mrs. Sunigi in Jakarta, who taught him in the first, second, and third grade. I don't think this is described in any other book, as far as I know. So this is really original research. And I describe in detail how they remember this story and why it's relevant. And I corroborate the story with other daycare workers in his family at the time. Okay. And then at the age of 10 years, Obama returned to Hawaii to enroll in an elite preparatory school called the Punhu School, the largest private school west of the Mississippi River. It is, if you can Google it and see, it's an elite school, has been there for 150 years, roughly. So it's the oldest school west of Mississippi River, and it's the, I think, potentially the most wealthiest school west of the Mississippi River. It was originally set up to train the missionary, children of the missionary. And so it has a Christian-based ethic and curriculum. And I argue in the book that partly it's here at Punahou that President Obama acquires a kind of a service ethic, community service ethic. It's part and parcel of the curriculum before he even gets to Chicago, right? Because it's at Punahou, you're required to do community projects as part of your early education. And you're also required to attend chapel every week and pray in a Christian way every week. So, this is not something that's talked about extensively when people talk about his years in Indonesia or years in Hawaii, but it is a fact that Punahou is a Christian, has a Christian-based curriculum, and has community service as part of its curriculum, which impacted him early on. So on the basis of direct interviews with several of his high school teachers and mentors, I demonstrate that Punahou really sheltered Obama from the negative stereotypes, in some ways, of his African-American, emerging African-American identity, because there weren't that many blacks on the island at the time. I think he was only, when he was attending, he was only one of the three students who was, quote-unquote, African-American. And he was very reserved and seen as very intelligent by a lot of his peers. But he mixed in with everybody and was very much part of the Punahou family. Did not stand out necessarily as the, you know, one of the three black students. And so he felt sheltered as an African-American student, but explored, you know, the contours kind of his identity, African-American identity, really in the privacy of his grandparents' apartment, where he was reading, you know, biographies of Martin Luther King or Malcolm X or Du Bois, and trying to figure out who he really was. And you really see this play out when he leaves the island for the first time to go to college. First, he goes to Los Angeles to Occidental College, and then he goes to Columbia on the Upper West Side here. And so when he leaves the island for the first time, he goes through the process which a lot of Hawaiians go through, right? They go through a kind of a culture shock, because Hawaii is very different. It's ethnically mixed. Everybody kind of gets along, at least the aloha ethic, you know, which says that you were all part of one big family or ohana, is very much a lived experience. And then he's in LA at Occidental, and he finds that's not what the mainland is like, that LA is very segregated. And then he comes to New York, he finds that New York is further segregated into its ethnic or cultural or economic pockets. And he's kind of shocked by that experience, and he writes about this in his autobiography. So the journey really from the island to the West Coast and then to the East Coast and then to the Midwest becomes a journey of self-discovery in many ways, as he's trying to figure out who he is, right? Because he talks about in his biography in telling detail how even like early in his adolescence, it did not register to him that he was black or that his grandparents were different in terms of racial classification than he was, because he wasn't raised that way. And so it doesn't really fully enter his mind that in some ways he's different, till he obviously gets to the mainland and then finds his roots in Chicago, and dedicates his life to community organizing. All right. So that's the chapter about global schooling in Jakarta. There is a chapter, this is an important slide, so I should quickly say something about this as well, in the sense that this is the chapter there's a chapter in the book that talks about the women who shaped Obama. Given his father left early, his mother, his grandmother, and then Michelle Obama are figured prominently in his biography as the anchors that kind of define not only his values and his way of moving in the world, but also the things that he really cares about. In terms of family or being a father and caring for the next generation. So I talk in detail about how, and as Maya did earlier, how his mother fostered that in the first 10 years of his life, and then his grandparents, who were his guardians from the age of 10 to 18, fostered in him a kind of a Midwestern ethic of hard work, responsibility, family values, raised him with that sense of meaning and purpose. And then, of course, when he gets to Chicago, he meets Michelle Obama, who's already at the law firm where he interns as a law student in the first year, and then she becomes his mentor, literally. And then the story evolves from there. So the women who shaped Obama is kind of a critical chapter in the book. This is the Obama statue at the Menteng Park he used to play when he was 8, 9, 10 years old in Jakarta. Now there's a statue dedicated to him at the park. This is the pictures from Punahou Academy. His homeroom teacher, who was with him for 4 years in high school, whom I interviewed extensively for the book. And then when he gets to the mainland, he gets busy with, you know, establishing his identity, who he is and where he fits in. These are some pictures from New York, Central Park with his grandparents, as a community organizer in Chicago, and then on the campaign trail with his sister. Okay. In the concluding chapters of the book, I also examine a little bit about, I get into the Obama campaign imagery and why it was significant. I look at his father's image, a mythic image that was sort of cultivated by his mother after the father leaves the family. His mother and his grandparents fostered a kind of an image of his African father as being highly intellectual, very bright, a great speaker, who worked for the Kenyan government. And all of that was true early in his life. But then when he goes back to Africa, his career takes a downturn. He takes liking to drinking. He remarries a number of times. And then his life kind of begins to fall out of control a little bit. And President Obama discovers this when he goes to Chicago, when he leaves New York, goes to Chicago, and has a visit with his sister, African sister, Auma Obama, who visits him for the first time in Chicago, and tells him all about their father, Obama Sr. And at that time, he has a revelation about how his father was not the man that he thought he was, right? And there's a great scene in the autobiography where he talks about how the Emerald Curtain has been pulled, the king has been dethroned, and that now he could kind of do whatever he wanted to do with his life. And that this, you know, this highly idealistic image of his father is no longer there to tell him what to do. Okay. Why is this significant? Well, it's significant because, you know, the book Dreams for My Father is a dedication in a way, in many ways, to his father. And the book actually begins when he arrives. The opening chapter of the book is really when he arrives in New York and gets a call from his Aunt Jane in Nairobi, who says that his father has passed away. This is the man that he did not know, except for 1 month in the Christmas of 1971, when he visits him and stays with him in the same apartment that Maya just talked about, the apartment on Britannia Street near Punahou Academy. It's a very modest two-room apartment, and it's no longer owned by the family. It's owned by a Chinese-American real estate developer, who quickly, you know, rented the space because he needed the money. So, Obama family doesn't really have any kind of a property in that building or in Hawaii, for that matter. And so, this is the apartment that Maya was just talking about. So, in this apartment, President Obama, you know, lives for a month with his father, and quickly, as he talks about in his autobiography, the Christmas vacation turned into the vacation that Grinch had stolen from him, because his parents and his mom and dad were fighting with their grandparents and talking about how little Barry should be studying more, and his father was admonishing him and so on and so forth. And so it has some interesting details biographically about the man he did not know, but that he had imagined him to be this great, you know, economist. And then when he grows up, he realizes his father's shortcomings, and then pursues a path, interestingly, to outdo his father, right? To become a lawyer, to go back to Harvard, to become a civil rights lawyer in particular, and to do something for the African American community. This is certainly the inspiration that one can glean from his biography. So while looking at the imagery, his campaign imagery, his rhetoric about hope and change, and alongside his mother's life and work in Indonesia, like Maya just talked about, and his father's life and work in Kenya, I conclude that Obama is really a reformer and a change maker of global proportions, partly because his parents, mom, his mother and father, were doing in many ways international development and economic development in places around the world. His father in Africa, his mother in Southeast Asia, and this is the spirit that moves President Obama still. Second, I argue that he's really driven by a heroic impulse in some ways to make the world a better place. Again, inherited from his parents, this is really what emanates him as a reformer. This is somebody who, as a teenager, as a young graduate student, as a young college graduate, leaves a Wall Street job to go become a community organizer because he's driven to change the world or to make the world a better place. And third, I argue that as a true reformer, Barack Obama has lived out really in a way his family drama or his family complexes on the public stage by releasing an autobiography at a very young age. You know, at the age of when he wrote it, he was, I think, barely just entering his 30s. And though his career has had many changes and permutations along the way, his life and work in many ways reflects a continuation of the kind of work his mother and father were doing around the world or globally. So in concluding, chapters in the book, I argue that Obama is really a global president, because of all of his rhetoric, as well as of his early years in Hawaii and Indonesia and the kind of upbringing that he had. And I also try to then link it up with the question of the changes that are going on in America at this time. Principally, I talk about three big changes. The first, the demographic change that's taking place in the country domestically, where the country is becoming more diverse. And according to the U.S. Census, by 2042, will be a country that will have 50% Caucasian population and 50% ethnic population that will make up the United States. And Hawaii, in many ways, reflects that demographically. And a lot of the Southwest and Southern states and states like California in the West also are heading that way demographically. And Obama, in many ways, having come from Hawaii, is a reflection of that demographic change that is taking place in the United States, which obviously elects electoral politics. Because President Obama, when he was elected, he won anywhere on the order of 65 or higher percentage of the votes from various ethnic groups, including Asians, Hispanics, and obviously in the high 90% from the African American population. So that's one big change that I talk about in terms of electoral politics and how we elected President Obama in the first place as the first multicultural head of any Western democracy. And then second, I also talk about the radical threat of Islam in detail in the post 9/11 framework and how that resonates with Obama's biography as the first president to have spent significant amount of his childhood four and a half years in Indonesia, the largest Islamic populist democracy, which according to even Hillary Clinton and Paul Wolfowitz, is the model that other Islamic countries need to follow in order to democratize in the future. And then the other big change that's taking place is, of course, a change from outside in terms of globalization, pushed very much by American companies, American venture firms and businesses to connect the world via technology and via international business, which has now really come full circle, right? So outsourcing fostered by American companies has now taken jobs overseas, right? Which has had some deleterious impact on the domestic economy here. And that has raised a lot of anxiety and fear about a kind of a globalized fear about change that is taking place structurally in the American economy, which is as much a global economy as it is domestic in terms of input, GDP input, and so on and so forth that we can talk about in detail. Anyway, so I spend a good deal of time talking about that change. That is the change of the last 70 plus years where America has been dominant economically in the world, to the 21st century, where other countries, namely China, and particularly is the rising economic power in the Pacific. And again, this resonates with Obama's biography to the extent that he grew up in the Pacific in the 70s and 80s and saw Japan and the tiger economies coming into their own, right? And now to that Asian Pacific hemisphere, China obviously is taking the lead economically, where growth is taking place by leaps and bounds. And so as the first multicultural president, as the first Pacific president, Obama understands this process, at least intuitively, having grown up in the Pacific, I argue, you know, reasonably well. And that's another reason why he's our first global president. Okay, but the challenges remain nonetheless, right? So in the last chapter of the book, in the last part of the last chapter of the book, I suggest that even if the midterm election returns are an indicator that Obama will be a one-term president, I'm not saying that he will be, I'm saying this, you know, if you look at the poll numbers now, that could be an eventuality, that he would not necessarily be like a transformational president, a paradigm changer, as he argued 3 years ago that he would be, you know, with coattails, linear coattails to follow. He would nonetheless be a significant marker for future generations. He would still leave a legacy, I argue, for the next generation to follow, which is really the central theme in middle age, which is where he is. He's 50, 51, to foster the next generation, which is kind of what he's concerned about on a day-to-day basis. And because the paranoid style of American politics in some ways has taken hold of the American imagination and the political process, and Obama is often seen as still, 3 years into his term, as the foreigner who still does not have a valid birth certificate, according to some, or a Muslim, or a socialist, you know, that the anti-Obama chorus obviously has grown significantly. But as a progressive politician, or a centrist progressive in some ways, he has unleashed several, you know, progressive tools and technologies that over time can deliver the change he has promised. Right, whether it's green energy technologies or his STEM policy in terms of education, science, technology, engineering, math, right, these are some of the changes he's put forth to renew the American dream for the next generation. So these are the challenges that he faces, as I argue in the book, the rise of China and economies, and the BRIC economies. You know, is America going to remain dominant in the 21st century as it did in the previous century? And the clash of civilizations, if you will, in terms of the rise of Islamist forces around the world? And can America innovate? Right, these are the challenges that the Obama world is wrestling with on a day-to-day basis. But his global image remains, you know, still very buoyant. According to nonpartisan, you know, surveys by Pew and others, his numbers remain fairly high, 60% or higher around the world, except in Islamic countries like in Pakistan, Afghanistan, Turkey. His numbers have fallen partly because of the two wars we're still engaged in and the escalation of the war in Afghanistan specifically, and recently Libya. His numbers have fallen in the Islamic democracies, Islamic populist democracies, but around the world he gets high marks for foreign policy as well as for the bailouts, surprisingly. In European capitals, he gets high marks for the bailout of the economy, of Lehman Brothers and so on and so forth, and of the auto industry in the United States, which I know is a highly controversial point domestically in electoral politics here. So reimagining the American dream for the 21st century. And I have a quotation here from Thomas Jefferson going back all the way to the founding of the nation, where Jefferson said, you know, but thank heaven the American mind is already too much open to listen to imposters. You know, real knowledge that's been gained can never be lost. You know, and that America can change and transform yet again for another century. right? Thank you very much.
The book is very rich. Many people will be mining the research, the interviews, the anthropological description of the different contexts Obama lived within. And I really have very little argument with the account of his life. I think I learned a great deal. What I would add today is three things. One, the sense of Obama having the style and mentality of an anthropologist himself, like his mother. Two, what I would call his third worldism, which is another way of looking at his cosmopolitanism. And third, Chicago. Since I've written about Chicago, I spend a fair amount of time there, and I'll explain it. But just the first, Obama in Dinesh Sharma's manuscript and other things I've read about him, and he's the first president I haven't spoken with and spent time with since 1984. I've been lucky and fortunate enough to either spend time with persons who became president or a person who ran against them every year since then, every presidential year since then. But so I'm basing this entirely on secondhand knowledge. But I've talked to many people who we work with in Chicago, and they all describe him as having the mentality of an anthropologist. All, many of them describe him as having them. That is, he reads cultural codes. He understands what's expected of him in particular situations. And I think his background, as Dinesh lays it out in Hawaii and Indonesia, allows you to see that. The way he learned to adapt and make sense of different situations. So that in that sense, he's very much his mother's son. Third worldism. The Indonesia he grew up in was known for its syncretic Islam, an Islam influenced by domestic Indonesian religions. Indonesia since then was enormously influenced by Saudi oil money and the rise of puritanical Wahhabism. So I'm not sure that we can pull forward from that Indonesia he saw, or that he can pull forward from the Indonesia he saw to what exists today. And although Indonesia is in some ways a successful society, the northern part of Indonesia, Aceh, is a hotbed of Wahhabism, of militant Islam. The idea of the third world as a political and ideological force begins in part at a conference in Bandung, Indonesia, in 1955. And another way of looking at Obama as a global president is to think about third worldism. The idea of third worldism was that countries like Indonesia, Algeria, Cuba were going to show the world the future, that they were the future of reform, change, humanism, et cetera, et cetera. That obviously turned out not to be the case. About 300,000 people died in Algeria in the intra-Islamic wars of the last 25 years. Indonesia has a mixed record. And Cuba, under Castro, Cuba went from being the wealthiest island in the Caribbean to being an economic backwater. So third worldism, it's hard to talk about it today because it was once such an important concept, so central to the political life of African Americans, especially activist African Americans in America, and it's been forgotten. But Obama grew up very much in a third worldist intellectual framework, the idea of the third world redeeming and healing the first. And much of what's disliked about him derives from that third worldism. The notion of the paranoid style I have to talk about a little bit. It shouldn't be used too loosely. At the very moment Richard Hofstadter, who I knew, was writing about the paranoid style, American liberalism entered into a long paranoid phase from which it has yet to exit. At the very same time he's writing that article for Harper's in 1964, the notion that Kennedy was assassinated by conspirators known and unknown took hold. I remember as being a young man in college, staying up all night listening to a guy named Long John Neville. Anyone here remember Long John Neville? He was a few people. He was a New York radio guy, and he was on all night long, every night, with Jim Garrison in New Orleans, who turned out to be the district attorney in New Orleans, who turned out to be an incredibly shady character himself. But at the time, I was much taken with. And professors would come into class and talk about the CIA conspiracy, the Lyndon Johnson conspiracy. So the Hofstadter argument is an unfortunate one. It didn't work then, it doesn't work now. I don't want to go on too long. Chicago. I don't know how many of you spent time in Chicago. Chicago's a very different city than New York. New York has many failings, but official corruption, I don't mean functional corruption, official corruption is rather low in New York compared to Chicago. Crime rates. Chicago has a murder rate per capita 3 times that of New York. Think about that. 3 times that of New York. And yet it's not a political issue there. It's a very different place. Chicago, the old joke goes, is a city inhabited by African Americans, Poles, Lithuanians, Czechs, et cetera, of no known European origin. In other words, it's a melange which has never had a universalistic ideology, as the way New York did. In Chicago, the reformers, in terms of good government, tended to be racist. The people who weren't racist tended to be corrupt as hell. Again, a very different political culture than New York. And much of what I see in Obama derives from that Chicago experience. Chicago is the American capital of crony capitalism. Well, what I mean by crony capitalism is everything is a transactional deal. You want to build something on the south side of Chicago, you've got to go through City Hall. It's all connections, what in Chicago they call clout. And just a brief story. I first learned about Barack Obama in 2006. A fellow I knew, Edwin Eisendrath, was running for governor against Rod Blagojevich. Eisendrath was a good man, I thought. He'd been involved in tearing down racially segregated projects near downtown Chicago and replacing them with mixed income housing. And it was considered a considerable success. He was a decent guy. He was honest. He went to Blagojevich. He wanted to run against Blagojevich. But by 2006, anyone who was sentient knew that Blagojevich was as crooked as you could possibly be. He went to Obama to ask for Obama's endorsement against Blagojevich, and Obama turned him down flat. I didn't know what that meant at the time, but it set off alarm bells. Who is this guy that people are touting in Washington are touting to me? And what I discovered is that Obama was a typical Chicago politician. No one in Chicago would remotely describe him as a reformer unless they were talking to gullible members of the Washington Press Corps. There are no reform efforts he's associated with one minor exception having to do with the videotaping of police interrogations. In Springfield, he was part of the machine. He was part of the Emile Jones machine. In Chicago itself, and his first political aspiration was to run for mayor. And if you look at the dicey associations he had with Bill Ayers, with Reverend Wright, with Louis Farrakhan, it makes perfect sense if you're running for mayor of Chicago. It doesn't make a great deal of sense if you're going to be a national leader. So in February 2008, I wrote an article explaining why I thought that if Obama won the nomination, at that point I didn't think he would, I was wrong, he would not be an effective president, that he would be unaware of how the country worked and how the national economy worked. And I think I've been generally confirmed that I don't see him as a reformer. I see him as a classic Chicago patronage politician for whom all politics is transactional. And just a few seconds more and I'll stop. If you look at who's central to the administration, this book that came out by Ron Suskind talks about the fact that the Chicago people run the administration lock, stock, and barrel. Richard Daley, Rahm Emanuel, Valerie Jarrett, David Axelrod, they were the core of the administration. And so the high-priced, and sometimes intelligent, sometimes, by the way, not so intelligent advisors, were really shunted aside. And they bring with them that set of associations. So Richard Daley, who's now chief of staff, worked for J.P. Morgan Chase. That's where he comes from. He comes from the Daley machine. Richard is the longtime mayor, son of the former mayor, brother of the man who was mayor until Rahm Emanuel became mayor just recently. Rahm Emanuel worked for Goldman Sachs when he left politics for a while. So this kind of cronyism is built into the White House, and that's essentially what's emerged. And when people talk about a green energy, green energy begins under Jimmy Carter. We spend massive subsidies on green energy. It's borne very, very little fruit. And countries that have gone bigger for green energy, Spain, it's been an abject failure. That doesn't mean we shouldn't work on green energy. Doesn't mean it won't be important for the future. It means that a lot of things like the Solyndra scandal are a function of claims for green energy that simply aren't there. So, looking at Obama from my perspective, which granted is a limited one, and doesn't deal in the depth with what Dinesh Sharma does, with the seminal influences on him, I have a very different sense of Obama. How many people remember who Adlai Stevenson was? Ran for president, Democratic nominee for president in 1952 and 1956. When Jake Arvey, then the boss of Illinois, was asked why Stevenson, who was notoriously honest, notoriously in Chicago honest, it was unusual for an Illinois politician. I think, five of the last six governors have gone to jail in Illinois. Blagojevich is hardly the exception. When Arvey was asked why he put Stevenson on the ticket for governor, the answer was, we had to perfume the ticket. And Obama served some of those same functions. Let me stop with perfuming the ticket.
I will give Dr. Sharma about 5 minutes to sort of reply to what we just heard, and then we'll ask you what you have to say about the various speakers.
So I want to thank Professor Siegel for reading the book, first of all. So I think he agrees with me in terms of the anthropological influence that comes from the mother and to some extent from his upbringing in Hawaii and Indonesia. I thank Professor Siegel for reading the manuscript and for pointing out, correctly that I described Obama kind of as an anthropologist, partly because of his mother's influence and because of the influences he acquired in Hawaii and Indonesia. Third worldism, right? So, and I think when you said third, the way Professor Siegel has used the word third worldism is really to target and focus on Islam and a kind of virulent Wahhabism that has, come to the fore. Before 9/11, obviously, there were several events, and then post 9/11. When Obama was there, Islam was syncretic, that it got along with other religions. And that's clearly, accurate description of Indonesia. Where I would disagree, and I think most economists would disagree today, whether they're conservative, supply-siders or believe totally in the market versus believe in government in terms of as the agent that stimulates the economy and so on and so forth. It depends on, all shades of economists today wouldn't necessarily use kind of the third world classification any longer. It just doesn't apply. When you have countries like China embracing capitalism, the ball game is completely different. It's no longer the paradigm of first world versus third world. When outsourcing is at a high pitch, information technology companies are setting up bases all over the world, including Indonesia. I think the frame to understand the world as first world versus second world, or developing versus developed, which is the more current term that economists have used, is limited. And then the final point, Chicago. Clearly, you know, my book ends where Obama's life begins in Chicago, and I wrote the book expressly for the purpose of distilling Obama's early years, because as a psychologist, as a social scientist, we believe that context matters and has an impact on your life story and on your worldview and your global outlook and even your politics. So my book doesn't really deal with the question that you raise at the end of your comments about Chicago. I haven't really done that book yet. Maybe I'll do that book next, right? Because there is an African American friend who wants me to come to Chicago and present the book to Reverend Wright and start a dialogue about, you know, about Indonesia and culture. And I'm kind of like of two minds about making that type of a move. I would love to do it, certainly to further, you know, elucidate this question about Obama's identity, political identity in Chicago, because that's where he breaks his political teeth, really. And then all of those questions that you raise about crony capitalism, corruption, murder rate, and of course, the Obama's inner circle, if he has an inner circle, right? Because there's also reporting that Obama does not really have an inner circle. He has a whole bunch of hired guns around him, and that his inner circle is, you know, very limited in the sense that very few people actually are able to get to the president in his inner circle. This was certainly the claim made by Washington Post reporter Scott Wilson, who called him the loner president, right? He doesn't do the retail politics that's required to win re-elections and so on and so forth. So again, I mean, these are all questions that I would love to have explored in my book, but my book is not about Chicago. So my book is really about the global Obama, right? Which is, why was this guy so popular around the world? Why were his poll numbers through the roof in 07 and 08 and continue to be very high, right? Why does he still get high approval numbers around the world, except for in Islamic countries, because he's been killing terrorists, contrary to what the conservatives thought he was going to do, right? I mean, he's increased the drone attacks by magnitude of five in Pakistan and in the South Asian region, which I know well. He's stacked up the list of enemies that he has been able to target successfully. So clearly he's not soft in terms of foreign policy, as a typical liberal progressive would be expected to be. So I think, but these are questions that I don't really deal with in my book, because my book's really dealing with the early years and the global Obama. So clearly the Chicago Obama, would be another project. There is a trait, so if you talk to a personality psychologist and other developmental psychologists, they will say there are certain traits that you acquire in childhood that continue on. And one of them would be introspection, that President Obama does have an introspective core. So he's oftentimes seen as a loner president, as the Washington Post reporter has talked about. There's also traits such as extroversion, being outgoing, that remain stable over time. Clearly, if you're an anthropologist, trying to culturally decode other people's worlds and read them and then respond appropriately, certainly you would be seen as a compromiser. And clearly, this is not, so another way of phrasing that would be, this is not the angry black man that we elected, right? He's not that. And Shelby Steele, yeah, he's made that argument in the book Bound Man, that Obama is really a compromiser. He's the prototype of the African American male who says, I'm not gonna get angry, I'm not gonna blow up, I'm not gonna insult you, if you let me get ahead, or if you compromise with me, or if you negotiate with me. He's a negotiator, he's a compromiser. He's not the person who says, I'm gonna get angry and I'm gonna get upset for the injustices. social injustices that have been leveled against me. This is the claim that Steele makes in his book, The Bound Man. So I think, yeah, it fits the cultural description as well as, you know, the kind of the political kind of identity he acquired in Chicago over the years.
I would argue that that's not entirely accurate. I would argue that's not entirely accurate. Depends who's what you're referring to. If we look at the stimulus, after the election of 2008, the Republican Party was in total disarray. Understandable. Bush had been a failed president. Republicans had no idea where they were going. McCain was less than inspiring. If you remember in the 2008 campaign, Thursday, I think October 15th, McCain stands up and says, I'm going to announce tomorrow my economic program. Next day came, nothing happened. That was pretty much the end of the election. But when it came to the stimulus, and there were a whole series of thoughtful proposals, some from Republicans, what he produced was hard-edged. He wouldn't compromise, for instance, on rebuilding the electrical grid, which was something that would have had broad, broad political support. He insisted on essentially feeding the Democratic Party interest groups, and he wouldn't budge from that. On Obamacare, he would not introduce whatsoever tort reform. He could have brought a lot of Republicans on board with tort reform. After the 2010 elections, which produced the greatest Republican legislative victories since the 1920s, he gave his budget speech in February of 2011. Not a mention of budget cuts. That's what the election had been fought over. Government spending, the Tea Parties had emerged. There was no hint of compromise. So I think all the examples Dinesh used are accurate. He compromised on all those things, but a whole host of other things where he didn't bend. And that's, I see him as a kind of checklist politician, that he operates by checking off the interest groups that he has to maintain, whose support he needs to maintain. And that's what we're seeing going into this 2012 election, checking off the interest group boxes, which is very Chicago.
The book, if you actually look at it, does deal with it. But I had to do, you know, the publisher also had to do kind of a truth in advertising. I did not do field work in Africa for the book for the specific reason that President Obama really doesn't get to Africa till he's accepted to Harvard Law School, and then he makes his first pilgrimage, if you will, to the land of his forefathers, right? But Africa, as argued in the book in detail, is very much part of his imagination. It's very much part of his life. It's very much part of his day-to-day culture, right? And his upbringing. Again, very much, as I said earlier, because it's fostered through his mother and through his grandparents. And they do build a very idealized image of his father, right? And I mentioned Alma Obama's trip to Chicago, the first trip that he has with his, visit that he has with his biological sister, half-biological sister from the same father, different mother, for the specific purpose and to show the continuity with his African lineage, right? So in the book, I do talk extensively about the airlift to America that happened between 59 to 61, fostered by African-American donors as well as by the Kennedy administration. Harry Belafonte, I think, gave some money and so on and so forth. So there's a book actually out there called The Airlift to America, which talks about Wangari Maathai as well as other African-American intellectual young students who came over and then went back to build Africa. And Obama Sr. was part of that airlift, although there is some, you know, dispute about that as well, and controversy in the sense that he was not in any of the official airlifts. He made his own way. Okay. Correct. So, and I look at the Mamboya assassination as well in the book, because he was a cousin of Obama Sr. And Mamboya had supported him in Kenya in terms of giving him money and to travel. Correct. Well, if you depends who you read. So if you read Remnick's book. Okay. So you should read Remnick's book. He disputes that that fact. And then recent book, The Other Barack, by the Boston Globe reporter. She also points this out that, you know, that yes, there were other donors in America, in the U.S., who were working in Africa, including, this is detailed in the book, in some length. So I do talk about his African lineage in detail, and his association with Tom Oboya. It's just that because I didn't do field work in Africa, I didn't go to Kenya for the book, I couldn't advertise that, you know, Barack Obama in Hawaii, Indonesia, and Kenya. Although I would have loved to have done that, my advisor, you know, years ago, had worked in Kenya for 30 years and worked with the neighboring clan, the Gusii, you know, and had studied the Maasai as well. So that was another reason for me to kind of explore this lineage. But certainly, I do talk about Africa in the book. It's just that it's not in the title. And I do talk about Africa as kind of the land of his forefathers. Very much that President Obama talks about in his autobiography, Dreams of My Father, and I connect a lot of his early, you know, his inspiration, clearly to his mother, but also to his father. Maybe that didn't come across in detail as much, but it's in the book. Did I interview Maya about President Obama's multicultural sense of, you know, belonging to different places? Yeah. That he's seen as an African-American person more so than, let's say, a person with multicultural kind of belongings and moorings, you know, and anchors in literally around the world. There's a well-known quotation in the book where President Obama says he's a man of many races, cultures, histories, and places. This is, you know, Barack Obama trying to make sense of his own genealogy. So he, you know, writes movingly. But certainly when he gets to Chicago, and as Dr. Siegel mentioned, you know, in much more depth than I did in the book, he becomes, you know, potentially, you know, a type of a Chicago politician on the south side of Chicago, and an African-American politician in the political system there. So clearly, you know, that political socialization, when it kicks in, he becomes that, you know. And then in his latest census, he did check the box, you know, box. He said he's an African American for his census identity. But, you know, my job in the book was to actually look at his earlier, belongings. And I did talk to Maya about this briefly in the frame that he has a global competence, or he has a cultural competence, that he can, you know, he's at home in Indonesia, and he said recently in the speech that he gave in Indonesia that Indonesia is part of him, you know, as much as he's on the south side of Chicago. Or when he's in Hawaii, you know. Yeah, I certainly see him through that lens, but, you know, that may be my perspective. I didn't specifically pose that question to her. But, you know, I can understand why he's predominantly seen as an African American politician. Do you want to?
I think Dinesh has it exactly right. In the context of Chicago, you come with the big battalions. So if you're a Lithuanian in Chicago, you're sort of a Pole, because the Lithuanians and the Poles kind of vote. That's Blagojevich's world. So you go with the largest group that's backing you, and that's what he did. In that sense, there's nothing unusual about it. And functionally, it was a very smart move politically. That's part of what made him successful, this ability to adapt, which I think one of the strong parts of the book is just the sense of a guy, because of his anthropological capabilities, has the capacity to adapt. And that's partly... what's puzzling about him as president, because he doesn't adapt to Washington. And part of the answer to that, if you look at the state of Illinois, in the last gubernatorial election, the guy who won, Patrick Quinn, the current governor, who's governing this a state that's got the biggest pension hole in the United States. It's almost Greek-like. It's so huge. Quinn lost 101 out of 104 Illinois counties. He carried, 100 out of 104, carried four counties, Cook County and the three collar counties of Cook County. So Obama, oddly enough, is a kind of reversal of what of the world Dinesh describes. When he gets to Illinois, there's this kind of cloistered Chicago politics that dominates the state. You can win the Chicago metro area and carry the state, losing every other single county in the state. And when he had to run a Senate campaign and deal with the people downstate, well, the political machine helped him. They knocked out other candidates in both the Democratic and Republican primaries. So he had an easy road. And so he arrives in Washington, not having dealt with kind of partisan conflict, because he's dealing in some ways with a one-party state, a deep blue state. I hope that makes sense.
Yes, yeah, so to add to that, you know, I do have interviews, and other people have interviewed actually President Obama about this directly, and what's revealed there is that, you know, unlike his mother, who was a world traveler, identified with many places, right, but may not have belonged to any particular place exclusively, right? So she was Hawaiian, she was the girl from Kansas, as Maya talked about it. She was Indonesian, the traveler, the world anthropologist, right? But if you know, a part of her life, she was literally living out of a suitcase as an anthropologist. You know, wherever she went, that was her home. And there's a very sort of detailed narrative and telling kind of interview. And I talk about this in the book, where President Obama himself has said, yes, I had already gotten a taste of that, and that's not what I wanted to be like. Right? I knew the advantages of belonging to all places, yet not feeling like you belong to any particular place specifically, so you're an outsider. So he wanted to belong to a place, right? And he made that decision very consciously in marrying an African-American woman, in settling down on the south side of Chicago, in setting up his law practice there, in becoming an African-American politician, in becoming a civil rights lawyer, in becoming a regular guy, you know, as Studs Terkel would say, the Chicago writer, and, you know, a basketball player and a lecturer at the University of Chicago, you know, somebody who was known as a local politician. You know, so that's what he chose to do. That's how he fashioned himself, in a way sort of reinvented himself to be successful. I would, you know, just to add to that, his level of adaptation is so, I think, facile in some ways, that is partly why he's able to win a coalition. I know, you know, in Senate race, you're saying he wasn't able to, the machine was there.
He didn't have to. In the Senate race, he really didn't have to assemble the kind of coalitions he would need when he got to Washington. So there's a way in which his short time in Washington before winning the presidency has hurt him. He didn't, for instance, he didn't get into those. He arrives in 2006. The Democrats are in charge of the legislative branch, so he doesn't experience what other people have experienced, that kind of intense partisan conflict. And so, and then when he enters the presidency, the Republicans are for the first year moribund. They're dead fish, and so I think he's taken by surprise. A lot of people are taken by surprise at what happened. But if you stand back and look at this, the Tea Party really begins in the 2006 legislative elections when the Democrats sweep the board. What happens is independents and a lot of Republicans stay home. They're so angry with Bush over a whole wide range of issues, but particularly spending, that they just stay home. And just let me wander from where we are for a second. 2008, Obama has this capacity to mobilize this broad coalition, carry states like Indiana and North Carolina that Democrats hadn't carried, and rarely carried. 2010, it swings the other way, dramatically. We're in a place now of enormous fluidity. And, you know, when people think that this election is sewed up, watch the referendum in Ohio coming up next month. that could change the momentum, change the direction of some of the, of American politics for a while. Doesn't mean it's going to. But does everyone know what I'm referring to? There's a referendum in Ohio about labor law, and this is a big test. And so in Wisconsin, the Republicans won. It's possible in Ohio. I'm sorry to get away from the personality. In Ohio, it's possible Democrats will win. And so we're in this incredibly fluid situation.
Right. But, you know, but as you rightly pointed out, the 2008 election, you know, was a landmark election in the sense his coalition was broad-based. I understand that the majority of the white population, certainly the men, I think over 55, that segment did not vote for him in large numbers, but everybody else did, you know, including the Asian American population, the Hispanic population, certainly the African American population, and white women voted for him in large numbers. So that was clearly a landmark election, and how he built that at the national level, you know, I think speaks to, again, this anthropological ability to communicate, you know, clearly from the teleprompter or from the podium, to unify the country, at least for that moment. Of course, there's nonpartisan data that shows clearly at that moment, both Democrats and Republicans, based on Pew data, felt that the country was unified. The country, there was more equality in the country. The country was racially harmonious. Of course, the numbers since then have gone, you know, in diverging directions, but, you know, it's still a year out to election day, you know, deadline. So, you know, of course, it's hard to tell what's going to happen, but I wouldn't, you know, underestimate this anthropological, this cultural ability to adapt. And I think, you know, there may be a core to Obama that doesn't compromise on certain issues. And I think you're right about that. Whereas he's compromised on a whole host of issues. And maybe now that he can't compromise with the Republicans, he's tried doing that on the deficit and the debt, that the use of the executive order, let's say, on, you know, student loans and a few of the initiatives, whether it's payroll tax and other things, you know, maybe in the works to mobilize the base. You know, we don't know where it's going to go yet, but, you know, I think it's still a bit too early to count, you know, I think President Obama out, especially given we don't know who the candidate is going to be from the other, you know, from the Republican side.
Yeah. I want to add a sort of more non-political perspective and make a comparison. People sometimes say you cannot be all religions. You can't be just spiritual. At some point, you have to be a part of a group that is religious. Otherwise, you're just a wishy-washy, diffuse, spiritual being that's at home nowhere. And you could apply this in the same way to Obama's decision not, in some sense, to live like his mother out of a suitcase, out of a ethnic suitcase in this case, but also a religious suitcase. Right? Or at least to me that appears to be a sort of a more psychological answer. Now, I think our time is up, and I would like to thank a number of people. First of all, the speakers, of course. And I hope I will speak on behalf of everybody if I say that I will send a letter in the direction of Hawaii thanking Dr. Soetoro-Ng for her contribution, because this is not something that a lot of people would have done.